on, the word is out. You know me, Marcel Teller. We out here in the streets laying it down like mayonnaise for you, like I told you. We talking to the candidates that's running for office. Don't change that channel. Matter of fact, give me a bowl of cereal too. No move. Right now, sitting to my right of me, I got my man, John Sharpe James. Say hello to the people.
How you doing? Word is out.
I finally got him on here, y'all. A lot of people, let me ask a quick question. And I just asked another person this one. A lot of people don't even know what a councilman is. Can you explain to the people out there what's their responsibilities for a councilman in that neighborhood?
Well, of course. Mm-hmm. Well, a councilman is a legislative branch of the city of Newark, mm-hmm. and they're responsible for ordinances, statutes. They're responsible for dealing with constituent concerns, our budget, mm-hmm. Just so many things. Really related to the community, how we manage our government, whereas the mayor and the administration is the executive branch. So we actually, you know, have to vote on things that the mayor proposes unless it's like an executive order. But mainly we want to do the best service for the community and citizen services. That's what it comes down to.
Man, you're going to have me running in a minute. Well, what I really want to talk to you about is, they say there's three main concerns in Newark. One concern is crime, you know, of course crime everywhere, schooling. And jobs, you know, I always talk about jobs all the time. What are some of the top topics that you want to tackle as soon as you become councilman?
Of course, those are some of the topics. Mm-hmm. And we have to look at it in a different approach right now. Mm-hmm. We have to look at it in a holistic and a cyclic view, because mm-hmm. education, lack of education leads some people to crime or lack of jobs. Right. Right now, we have our school district has been run by the state for 19 years, and Councilman Raj Baraka, running for mayor, myself, have been fighting to get local control of our school district. Mm-hmm. On the city council, we're trying to find money and funding, whether it be federal, state, or local, to have job training and programs for our residents. The bottom line is, if we have more economic development, we can break that cycle of poverty, that cycle of dropping out of school, committing crimes, not being able to find a job, and that's what we're trying to do, to make residents better prepared to deal with the business community and just better themselves.
Mm-hmm. Like I was asking the other candidates that's running, it's like a pyramid, and me personally, I think that if people can get more jobs out here, it would be better to stop the crime. It would be better for like domestic violence, even, mm-hmm. you know. It'd be better for, you know, kids stop going into gangs, because somebody was just telling me, they was like, they was talking to the kids out there in the street that's in the gangs, blood, Crips, whatever, and they said, man, if I could just get a job, you know, I don't even want to be in the streets. And I hear that a lot from these kids out here in the street. They don't even, the kids that's in the game, not even kids, I mean, guys that's 30, 40 years old that's in the game, they don't even want to be in it. But it's just something to do. And that's how sometimes they generate money.
Right. Well, one thing is people don't talk about a lot is, over the last 40 to 50 years, our business community has shed all kinds of blue-collar jobs, the manufacturing jobs, the jobs that generations of people used to work at. There aren't any factories anymore. There aren't any big companies that use just physical labor. So what are we left with? Service-orientated jobs, where you need a degree. 9/11 didn't help, because that required a background check for a lot of individuals to get the good-paying jobs or the moderate-paying jobs. So now, if you have a criminal record, certain jobs say, hey, we just can't hire you. Yeah. And then let's throw in discrimination and racism, which still exists, you know, and people not wanting to hire people of color. That's another issue. Mm. So without the blue-collar jobs, everything we wear now is patently made overseas, manufactured overseas. It's just not here. Mm. Federal money is drying up for programs like Speedy that Newark used to have, after-school programs, which will be ending May 1st, and summer school, which the Board of Education of Newark is now saying parents have to pay for. It's just unheard of, but, you know, if Republicans ever get in office again, they'll even cut even more programs. Right. But it's not easy. And we still tell those people who are inclined to go to gangs or in the gangs, you know, try and turn your life around. Right. I mean, you know, people start committing crimes, they just keep moving up on levels. Mm-hmm. By the fourth or fifth crime, now they're shooting somebody and they get serious time.
Exactly.
So Councilman Baraka is trying to deal with pre-entry, not re-entry. We are trying to interrupt the cycle of crime and poverty by several programs. And one is call-ins. And it's been used on a limited basis in Newark. But someone in the administration from the police department will form a case on someone who's a criminal, a high level in certain area, certain block area. You would call that person into a church. You would tell that gentleman, look, you're a tier 3 criminal. You go tier 4, you're doing serious time. Let us tell you something. This is your file. We know where you live. We know where your sister is, who your mother is, your brother is, your family. It's your girlfriend. It's where your boys hang out. This is where you run your operation. This is where your enemy is. We're telling you now. If anything happens under your umbrella influence, from anyone under your umbrella, we're coming straight for you.
Wow.
So that person at that time has two choices. He can either move to another area to do his business, or he can say, you know, I want to be part of a program, I want to get out, or I want to assist in this, that, and the other.
Right.
And this is coming from the crime experts. You know, this is not something, you know, fly by night that somebody's just coming up with an idea, hey, let's try this. This is actually being done. Operation Ceasefire in Boston, I believe, is using some of this, but we're doing it in Newark. And people may not be, you know, 100% favorable. But this is what the experts say are working, because it interrupts that individual from just saying, hey, I'm going to let all my underlings get caught, and I'm not going to worry about it, because they'll never get up to me, because I'm going to use all these mules and this, that, and the other, and they'll always get caught, and I'll still be the mastermind. No, they're going after the top guys, and in small instances, this is shown to be working. It needs to be done on a larger scale.
Like you was just now saying about some nowadays, they want to try to make the parents pay for some school. I just want to piggyback off that. Only thing what I was trying to say about that is, it's just something else. Like we were talking about, we had another show how society is changing from one thing into the other. And is it good for us, for the people? Me personally, I don't think so. You know, because they try to make you pay for everything. I mean, like, I hear if you try to get a job, they try to make you pay for this. You want to be a security guard, you got to pay for your store. If you want to do this right here, you got to pay for this. If you got bad credit, some jobs you can't get.
Right.
So, I mean, it's changing, but it's not changing. It's not good for the people. Right. And what I say, me personally, this is my opinion. What I say, like, you know, people who's making the laws and regulations, like Congress and them out there in the office, and them people don't, they haven't been struggling in a long time. They might tell you a story about their father, you know, what was that guy that did the 99 rule, where he was running against Barack Obama.
99 rule.
What's that guy that got? He was the only black guy against the block of Barack Obama.
Herman Cain.
He had the 999.
Oh, right.
And he said that, well, my father back in 1950s, 1940s, he did this, that, and the third, and he worked his bootstraps, and he became a good working man, and he did this, that. But it's different from 1940s and 1950s all the way up to 2014. And like what you were just saying, that, oh, you got to pay for summer school. They're trying to make you pay for summer school. They're trying to make you pay for everything, and you don't have any money.
Right.
You know, I mean, like, you know, it's not helping us. And they keep coming up with these rules and regulations, like what Cory Booker did. He had to just be on welfare and get a family first card and live off of that to understand what was going on.
Right.
You know, they don't know what it's like to be struggling. They don't know what it's like to be poor.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't keep putting laws out there saying, oh, okay, you got to pay for this, you got to pay for that. These people don't have no money to pay for anything.
Yeah.
So if I got a cousin that's selling coke crack, and my mother, she's struggling because there's no man in the house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's no man in the house. And she, we four or five of us, there's no food in the house. And she on a family first card. And they keep giving her to run around by putting food in the house. Because a lot of women, they got jobs and they still got family first card. And it's still not enough.
Right.
You know?
No, you're right.
So a young individual is, and somebody telling them, oh, yeah, you can make a lot of money. You can get a brand new pair of sneakers. You don't have to ask money from your mother because you can help your mother out and this, that, and third. That's why they're selling drugs. It's not right. It's not right at all. And I'm not promoting it. But this is what's going on. Now, if you go in the suburbs like Montclair and all of that, only reason why they joining gangs and doing stuff like that because it's cool.
Mm-hmm.
it's the end thing to do because, oh, yeah, that's fun. It's not fun, but they think it's fun because they're young,
they're
dumb.
They're rebelling.
Yeah, rebelling against their parents. But their parents is paying for everything. They don't need to do that. People in this in the urban area, they doing it because, oh, because they need to make the money.
You know? Well, one reason I'm supporting Councilman Ryan Baraka for mayor is while he was deputy mayor under my father, he organized a ceasefire between the Bloods and the Crips. I mean, it's like unheard of. You know, we have to communicate with them. We cannot sit here and ignore them. The United States has the largest incarceration rate in the world. So clearly, locking everyone up isn't easy. Isn't a solution. Mm-hmm. We still have more crime. Mm-hmm. There are less violent drug programs for those who are caught, addicted to drugs or this something to that effect, or minor offenses, nonviolent, where they don't have full incarceration. They're put on probation. You know, they're able to continue working and this, that, and the other. If there was a simple answer for everything, you know, it would be done. Right. And some people want minorities or African Americans to self-eliminate. You know, it furthers their agenda. I mean, if you look at what the Clippers owner said the other day, I mean, he lives in a whole different world. Yeah. And I'm so glad that we get a glimpse that racism is still alive and well.
Right.
And, you know, he feels, you know, that these African Americans that work for him, you know, are less than human, shouldn't be respected, shouldn't be seen, and shouldn't even go to his game. It's like unheard of for an NBA owner not to welcome African Americans to his basketball game.
He said it because he's living in another bubble. He's living in the outside, and he's looking in, and he see these just a bunch of black people acting stupid, wearing their pants hanging down, you know, wearing all, especially around rich black people. Now he's seen them hanging out because they from the ghetto and they got the ghetto mentality. He's seen them doing this, that, and third. I don't want to be bothered with that. I'm giving them the money so he can, you know, have my business going and flowing and stuff like that. But they lifestyle, I don't agree with it at all and stuff like that. And then I'm seeing these other people in the ghetto, and I'm looking at TV, they killing each other and stuff like that. And, you know, you watched it, ever watched the show The Next 48?
Yes.
Oh my God, it's terrible.
It's almost, I think it's self-hatred, you know, and we have to have better self-esteem.
Right.
We have to have more respect for ourselves, for others. It's a difficult situation because I feel the African-American community, you know, like it's fractured. You know, normally you don't have those traditional husband-wife homes anymore, two-parents home. You don't have those two parents bringing income to support, move forward, buying a house, getting married, raising a family. It's like the do me mentality, which, you know, isn't conducive to help a society.
Exactly.
And it's coming from the younger generation, you know, from the broken home, from those with abusive parents and drug abuse and lack of education, you know, and somehow we have to combat that.
Mm-hmm. You know? So getting back to what we were talking about before, the second question was the three things that's hurting Newark, New Jersey right now, which is schools, jobs, and schools, jobs, and crime. How is Roz and yourself gonna bring more jobs into Newark? I mean, like, I'm hearing like they bring in the war market. They trying to bring other businesses here because I see they building all around them. It probably will help after they get finished all the businesses and stuff like that. It was going to help people get them off the streets. Me personally, I think it's like if you get the people that want to work, that need a job, and you get them working, and you say, okay, now these people want to work. Now, since we got businesses going around and these people still want to do crimes, then that's when you deal with them. Because these are people that don't want to work, and you deal with them. You know, so that's how you separate it when you bring the businesses here. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so now, excuse me. So now you can just deal with them people right there. So right now there's people that need work. They need jobs. They need to take care of their family. And it's people out there that probably think about doing something criminal because they never ever did it before. But they say, you know what? My kids don't have any clothes. My wife is looking at me to be the leader. And, you know, and then all of a sudden they arguing, they fighting. Then there's domestic violence. Or they break up. You know what I mean? Now the kids see that as little kids, and it's a domino effect.
Well, you know, you're right. But a lot of people are digging themselves into a hole.
Right.
Because we're competing against the street mentality, what's cool and hip.
Right.
People are saying, look, I don't want to get educated. I don't want to waste time with school. You know, I'm gonna just drop out and hang out and be cool. You're dropping out, you're hanging out, you get someone pregnant, Now you're dealing with a child, or not dealing with a child. You leave her and you bounce out to somebody else. Now she's stuck with a child. She either finishes school or drops out. Mm-hmm. Now she's on welfare, and then they have all kinds of stipulations with welfare. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's not easy. Now the city of Newark has a one-stop center. It was supposed to be created to bring all these different agencies, state, federal, county, and city, into one office where people who need jobs can walk in, present themselves, and employers could come to Newark and go to that one facility and say, we're looking for an engineer, we're looking for a handyman, or we're looking for whatever. And these Newark residents would already be on file, and then boom, here you can contact them. Mm-hmm. But in a tough economic environment, I'm going to be honest, a lot of companies are just hiring their friends, not caring about our community, trying to get in here as cheap as possible and make the maximum profit. So
they're trying to get in our community cheap, but they're not hiring.
Right. So what we need to do is we need to enforce code inspectors, mm-hmm. you know, that used to go out and find violations. You know, mm-hmm. that was a chunk of African-Americans and Newark residents that were working. We need to, the affirmative action office, we need to send those inspectors out to job sites and you know, view who's working on your site, who's building your building, how many are actually from Newark. Cory Booker gutted all these apartments, and you know, it's been a major issue. So we need to get staffing back where code violators go out, find code violations, illegal dwellings, hazardous situations in families, in landlords. We have a lot of new landlords who are slumlords. Mm-hmm. So code enforcement officers are after that. Mm-hmm. Affirmative action officers are out on job sites ensuring that Newarkers get hired. We're still trying to lure more companies in. We also want to leverage more money from the seaport, the airport, and we have a lot of revenue that comes in the city, but it doesn't stay. Mm-hmm. People come into work every day, and they don't spend money like on our streets. We have 60,000 college students in downtown area. Mm-hmm. They don't leave their campuses. They don't come down and matriculate throughout downtown like they do in New Brunswick. You go to New Brunswick, you see college kids all over the place. Mm-hmm. So we need to, you know, let the money and the people grow in Newark. And then we need to have more people move in, more middle class individuals actually buy homes, mm-hmm. and not rent and work, and that money's here, they spend that money in Newark. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to address it from a bunch of angles, mm-hmm. and everybody has to buy into it. Right. City Hall can't do it alone. The police can't do it alone. They can't lock everyone up. Mm-hmm. The clergy has to be involved. The community definitely has to be involved. Right. And the business community, which I feel the private sector, you know, I mean, they need to have more concern. Everything isn't about profit. Mm-hmm. Anything isn't about numbers. You know, they didn't realize it. We're a vibrant community. We want to grow. We're ready to work. Those who are not ready to work, they'll be dealt with. But there are enough people here that really just want to support their families, as you stated, right. if they had the chance, if they had the opportunity. And mm-hmm. those are the people we need to work with all of those elements, and grow Newark to the next level, an international city, because we're trying to move beyond Brick City, because it just sends too many negative connotations.
Brick City? Yes. I mean, me personally, I went to school in New York, and I told them, I'm originally from Orange and East Orange.
Okay.
And they were like, well, Orange and East Orange? I'm like, yeah, I'm from Orange, East Orange, because I was going to school in Manhattan, you know, AI. And they were like, oh, Orange, East Orange. I'm like, Newark. Oh, yeah. We,
right. Yeah, well, it's like people Newark. Down south, they don't live in Atlanta.
Right.
They live, like, in Conyers, and nobody knows where Conyers is. So right. They say Atlanta.
Right, right, right.
And they might live an hour away. Yeah. But they say Atlanta.
Somebody's like, oh, man, you still not. I'm like, but they know Newark, and Newark and East Orange right there. Right. So right. I just say Newark, you know. But, yeah, like you said, Newark got that image about them about all over, not just in Jersey. And it's in New York, and everybody got that bad image about Newark. Oh, they the bad guys. They killing each other and stuff like that, you know. But, like I said, though, me personally, like I said, we got to get that job problem out of the way, you know. And I think that will affect the crime. Now, as far as schooling, I mean, like, I see, like, Chris Christie, you know, he's real big on bringing charter schools. Mm-hmm. You know, and try. A lot of people think that he's trying to eliminate, you know, public schools. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that charter schools, it does do is good. Me personally, because I have my kids in charter school, mm-hmm. and they work like on an individual level. And if you having a problem, if you got a problem with math or something like that, we want to talk to you individually. We want to do like a keep going over it with you. Keep going over it with you. And public schools, they're just ready to just pass you by. Oh, you don't understand it. All right, let's go to the next thing. Let's go to the next thing. Then you're in another grade and you still didn't learn anything.
Well, my issue is the state of New Jersey has run the city of Newark's Board of Education system for 19 years. Mm-hmm. In that 19 years, they've run into a deficit. They failed to increase test scores, and they still want to point the finger at Newark people in City Hall and Newark residents. Mm-hmm. Now, if you've had 100% control of the budget, of the curriculum, of the formatting, of the facilities, and you haven't been able to raise test scores, why all of a sudden do we jump to this big charter movement? Mm-hmm. I mean, you have not taken care of your constitutional duty to provide a quality education to mostly inner city youth, Camden, Trenton, Newark, mm-hmm. Patterson, taking over our school systems.
Right, right.
So you have failed to do that. And charter schools cannot take every student. Mm-hmm. They just physically, there aren't enough schools. And if you notice who's behind charter schools, it's big investors, because a charter school takes a chunk of our $1 billion school budget. And now the charter school person got a guaranteed revenue coming in, and they can hire their friends, whether they're qualified or unqualified. Who's going to be able to check them?
Right.
Now, at least North public schools have civil service. Mm-hmm. They argue about the unions, but if somebody really commits a crime or just is improper, I mean, you can get that black and white. Mm-hmm. But in a small charter school with maybe 40 individuals who are all friends or connected, mm-hmm. they're not going to rat each other out. And they're going to mm-hmm. keep siphoning off of that $1 billion and they're going to cherry pick what students go to charter school.
Yeah.
It's not going to be the bottom of the barrel kids.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be the ones who score the highest in the traditional public schools. Yeah. It's not going to be English as a second language student. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be special needs students. Mm-hmm. You know, there are some charter schools who take a few, mm-hmm. but the majority they're going to go after is parents of kids who are doing good in traditional public school.
Because what I see about charter schools, though, is, like you said, they don't have... I don't think they have enough money like in the fund, because they make them pay for everything. If you got a T-shirt, because everybody got to wear uniforms now, they make them pay for all that. Well, I think public schools do the same thing. But like when the kids eat lunch, if they bring no money in, then the kid can't eat lunch. They make them pay for every single thing. That's the only thing that gets me about charter schools. Did your parents pay for this? Well, you can't do this. And then the kid's sitting there like, did your parent pay for that? Then you can't do that. Like I said, it's all about money. Right.
And we need to move away from that. And there has to be some kind of holistic look at it. Like, look, mm-hmm. I shouldn't break into this person's house because this person worked hard for whatever they have in their house.
Right, right.
I mean, people need to have that belief, because I wouldn't want anybody breaking in my house.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't have that belief.
Mm-hmm.
And we breaking in our neighbor's house. These thieves aren't coming from out of town, catching a bus from New York.
Mm-hmm.
They're robbing people around the corner, down the street, this, that, and the other. I mean, like, we eating ourselves alive.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask a quick question. And I always talk about our boy on the show, Chris Christie. Does the brother got common sense? What I'm trying to figure out, man, because with Chris Christie, man, he making laws. And he just saying that, okay, now we're going to do this. Now we're going to save money. We try to do this because we save some more money. Now, do he care about the inner city youth?
Obviously not. First of all, I don't even know whether you know Chris Christie's background.
Right.
Do you know he was a lobbyist for Edison Education Corp., which is the largest not-for-profit education company in the world, or in the United States?
No, I didn't know
it. So while they were in Philadelphia and they took over a quarter of Philadelphia schools, made them charter,
mm-hmm.
Chris Christie was their lobbyist in New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Christopher Cerf, the former commissioner for education, was the CEO at that time, or the COO, chief operating officer.
Mm-hmm.
So he and Chris Christie worked together way back then. It'd be the 90s, 2000. I can give you the stats at any time.
Mm-hmm.
But they worked together. And when Christie became governor, who did he bring as education commissioner? Cerf, who used to be his boss.
Mm-hmm.
And then they brought in Cammy Anderson, superintendent. Cammy worked on Booker's campaign.
Mm-hmm.
So they brought in someone who a flunky, who would do what they want, go along with the program, and that's what she's doing. To the point where she's disrespecting not only the council, but Newark as a whole, because she refuses to come to public meetings.
Right.
How can you make your salary represent the face of public education, but yet you refuse to come to meetings? Mm-hmm. Unheard of.
Yeah, because I hear Chris Christie is getting rid of like some of the high schools. Like, he took away Shabazz.
Right.
You know, and he's trying to take away some more high schools. And he doing stuff like, I heard he tried to put toll booths on 78, 280, you know, 109. But I mean, I heard they abolished that, but he was trying to do that so to make some more money. Mm-hmm. You know, and he was trying to make some more money. So I'm like I said, it's all about money. But you trying to suck more money out of people that don't have money.
Right.
People more who don't have a job.
Right.
So if I don't have a job at all and I'm trying to get a job, and you saying, oh, I can't get a job because I got, well, we keep like, it's like repetition. We keep going over the same thing. But because it's real dear to my heart. You know, and they're just sucking more money. How you just I want money from this. I want money from that.
But you have to realize some people don't care.
Right.
They just don't care.
Because they've never been in that situation.
But not only that, but they're in a different level now, a position of power, and some of them are being told to do whatever. Cammie Anderson, I don't think she was wealthy before she took the superintendent's job. But now that she's in that position, making that fat salary,
right,
you know, she's going to do what they tell her.
Right.
You know, I'm sure she's been poor, mm-hmm. you know, or not known where her next paycheck was coming from. Right. When she was working for Corey's campaign in 2002, you'll see in a street fight video, barely, she was just a regular worker. She wasn't the campaign manager, you know, wasn't the GOTV director. You know, she was just a regular worker, maybe volunteer.
Well, that's a human thing. I mean, like, if you've been broke and poor and you was scraping and scribing just to pay the rent, and all of a sudden you just got this great job, but they're saying, like, you know, it's not helping the people, it's going against the people, and you making like $100,000, $200,000 a year now, and you like, these people don't have no job, and you taking away schools and stuff like that, you might say, well, you know what, this is wrong, but I still got to pay my bills.
Right.
You know, and that's what I think Congress is doing. You know what I mean? I mean, Barack Obama, I got a lot of respect for him. But if he's the president, but he can't pass no law because he got to go through Congress first. Mm-hmm. But what's he there for?
Well, the hope was that Congress would work with him for mm-hmm. the best interest of moving this country forward. Unfortunately, that hasn't been the case. And at every turn, they try and block. Right. And so it's unfortunate. But I think the community and the nation as a whole is seeing that, and they're saying, making comments like, the stat is in, like, this Congress really didn't pass any legitimate, you know, laws. It's the most ineffective Congress they've said in decades, practically. So, but I think the public knows that, and they generally believe, you know, Barack Obama's not perfect. He's just like everyone else in a high state office. He's trying to do his best. But when you have blockades and obstructionists like Congress, and the Tea Party and the Republicans, I mean, it's tough. But the hope and intent is that Congress and the president work together. Just right. like in Newark City Hall, the hope is that the council and the mayor work together. Now, the council should never rubber stamp the mayor, but they should both work in the best interest of the Newark resident and those who deal with Newark, whether they be students or businesses or just visitors or transients, moving through the city.
And that's the problem with the working man, the working class, and the poor. They look at people that's in office like they don't care nothing about them. Mm-hmm. You know, they look at the councilman, they look at the mayor, they look at the governor, they look at the senator, they look at the president, Congress. They look at all these people. Okay, these people is doing well for themselves, and they go in these office and they making all these rules and regulations. But how that's helping me out? It's not helping me out. I mean, I know people that's going through problems. They got to go down to the welfare office down there on Rector Street, and they give them the runaround. You know what I mean? And people that really need it, because people abused it, they're like, oh, okay, now we're looking at all these people, black people, Puerto Rican, whatever you are. Since these people abused it, all of y'all trying to use and abuse the system, and that's not the case.
It's a stereotype.
Right. And some people really need like things like TRA. Because they're trying to look for a job because it's not jobs here. But they give them the runaround. Because I know, quick story. I know somebody who just went through something this summer. They lost their job. They say that welfare said they could help them out. Welfare said you got to be behind rent at least 2 months before we can help you out with TRA. Mm-hmm. They said, okay, you know, they're still looking for a job. You know what I mean? Nobody never called them back. 2 months went behind. It was behind rent on 2 months. They go back to the welfare office. They said, oh, well, you got to do this paperwork. Oh, you're behind two months? Okay, now do this paperwork and stuff like that and bring it back. Fill this out, this, that, and third. Bring the paperwork back. Then it's like, okay, if you laid off, right? Well, they laid off until September. Oh, okay. But we behind 2 months. Come on, let's go. You say you could help us out like a couple of months ago. They about to kick us out. Okay, well, find out what's going on with your unemployment status. Then they got to go to the office for the unemployment. And then the unemployment people say, oh, well, you getting some money. Now, then they say, okay, well, it's not going to be enough to pay the rent. You know? So in the meantime, welfare is telling them, okay, well, until you find out what's going on with your unemployment status, then we can't do nothing for you. So they can be kicked out on the street. Now, what we're going to do the grapevine is they always do that so they can make you get frustrated enough so you won't bother them anymore.
But you have a right to go to both offices. And the bottom line is some people have high salaries. Mm-hmm. So their unemployment might be able to cover the rent. Mm-hmm. You don't know.
Right.
So welfare needs to know before they just start paying people.
Right.
That, I mean, it may be frustrating, but that's a legitimate process.
Right.
I mean, nobody planned on unemployment or the circumstances. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, it's a paper trail.
Right, right.
They can't just say, okay, we're going to take your word. You get money from welfare. And then unemployment is paying them too.
Why are you running for council?
I'm running for council because I love this community. I'm born and raised. I'm on Pomona Avenue now, but I was born on Wilbur Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
And growing up, you know, my father was elected to office when I was two. So mm-hmm. I saw politics from inside the household, but I really didn't engage in it. First job was at Burger King. Went through St. Benedict's Prep downtown. Mm-hmm. When I went to college, I went to Morehouse in Atlanta. I joined the military 6 months in. You know, so I served my country. I really wasn't into politics. I was into the community because, you know, back in the 60s and 70s, you know, everyone was community orientated. It was the end of the civil rights. Well, the middle of the civil rights era and movement, everyone was, you know, trying to empower each other, the community, the people. And so, you know, I got a taste of that. And I educated myself. In the military, you know, you sacrifice because you're not home. You don't have the creature comforts. I'm infantry, I'm airborne, I'm a paratrooper, served in Desert Storm. And so while I was in, trying to think, not Desert Storm, when I came back in 2006, they asked me to run because Cory Booker, who had run against my father in 2002, had spent a lot of money, had built, ran by himself and lost. And the community said, look, we need people from the community, not folks like him who are going to bring in outsiders. And I was drafted by the community to run for the South Ward. Part of the politics, or politricks, as they say, is they ran somebody with the same last name, Oscar James II, against me, and told folks he was the mayor's son. So it confused a lot of people. But with Booker's backing and his funding, I mean, he looked more like the mayor's son. He had an entourage. He had some SUVs. I mean, he almost looked like, you know, Obama when he got out of a car. So he was able to win. And, you know, I've seen him recently. And, you know, no harm, no foul. You know, I think he's, you know, doing the best in his situation. But I lost that election in 2006. Mm-hmm. And so I stayed with it. I've stayed involved in the community. I was a former president of the South District Police Community Relations Council. They're an organization founded in the civil rights era, and they were founded to stop a disconnect between the police and the community. So what they do is every third Tuesday of the month they meet at the police precinct, regular citizens from the community, the majority from the South Ward, and the police. And we talk about strategies and crime initiatives and what's going on in the community. People have personal issues, they talk directly to the police officer. So in doing that, you know, more involved in the community, I was the former commander for the Guyton Callahan American Legion Post down 212 Elizabeth Avenue. Mm-hmm. You know, just doing what we can do for veterans and the community. And so when 2010 rolled around, Raz and I ran together in 2006. 2010 rolled around, we banded together our community team, underfunded against the $9 million Cory Booker juggernaut. And in 2010, we were able to get Raz Baraka elected South Ward Councilman. I had ran for large. and still had a good showing with all the money they spent against us. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I've been out here, you know, running for the people, with the people, protesting major issues, was against the MUA, was against the police layoffs. And so, you know, my positions have always resonated with the community. And when Donald Payne Jr. Replaced his late father, Honorable Donald Payne Sr., mm-hmm. as a congressman, that left that open council seat. And if you remember, November 2012, they had a riot because some people affiliated with Cory Booker tried to fill that seat with someone who didn't even run for office. Now, I was the next highest vote getter. Mm-hmm. And so the judge vacated that, but said you have to wait till the next general election. So I had to wait a whole year till November 5th to run for that seat. And so the community overwhelmingly elected me against the two young women I ran against by a 3-1 margin. I run, you know, at 12,000 votes, they had close to 3,000 to 4,000 apiece. And so that's, you know, that's been my involvement, politics. It's, I could have taken the easy way and cut a deal to get in office. I could have been in City Hall while my father was mayor, a councilman. But, you know, I took that, the right path, the harder path, and educated myself, served 23.5 years in the military, served and volunteered for combat duty in Afghanistan, spent 9 months over there on the front lines, earned a Purple Heart, was blown up, was in command over there, and then, you know, came back home. And so I'm in the sacrifice, I'm in the fighting for the community, and that's why I'm running, will continue to run, and try, you know, put the community in the best light, because they need people who are not just there for themselves, people committed to growing the community instead of personal agendas, as we saw with Cory Booker. And I believe the people running against Raz, they definitely have a personal agenda, because I haven't seen them out in the community.
My cameraman is about to scout me like an Indian in a minute. But can I ask one quick question? Make you talk about your father. Was a great mayor, because a lot of brothers in the hood respect him and love him. How are you going to follow behind his footsteps?
Well, obviously, I'm an elected official. So the key is, you know, for him, you know, always be with the community, be involved, help people when you can. You know, try to help people, even if you can't help, you try. You know, but people just need to learn, you know, not to self-eliminate, you know, have more perseverance, you know, because nothing's easy. You know, unfortunately, you know, my father went through his whole trial. I mean, right now, my father's unemployed. My father hasn't been employed since 2010. Now, it's amazing that someone who could run a city as large as Newark for 20 years, and, you know, be a council person for 16 years, all of a sudden, nobody wants to hire him. I mean, it's just
part of
politics. You know? He's served, you know, his time.
Yeah.
And, you know, I really want him to retire. But right now, you know, he's helping my campaign. Mm. So I have him out putting out literature, knocking on doors, rallying the troops and everything. And so I love him for being with me. And, you know, sometimes you have to go through something. And he has a different appreciation on life now because of what he went through in politics. And part of it because Christie, Booker, and other folks who just felt he was too connected to the people, too powerful as an African-American, and punish him, in effect, when during his trial, you know, the judge said he didn't take any money, he didn't receive any money, you know, and he still had a jury that went by the news media that painted him as so horrible. And, you know, I just love my father, and I think he did the best. And that's the only reason I have a chance at success now, besides my personal legacy, is because so many people also love my father, and he gave people second, third, fourth chances. Professor at Essex County College, you know, president of the National League of Mayors, and just the same person with all those titles never went to his head.
Like you say, he connected with the people in the streets. Right. I mean, I hear that he'll come out there, be with the people, talk to them, be visible. You know, you need a job? Come see me tomorrow morning. Right, you know, stuff like that. And they say they love Sharpe James for that.
Exactly.
You know. Well, let me roll this up. because, like I say, he's going to kill me with a bamboo stick.
Well, thank you for coming to my humble home.
I love talking to you, man.
Sorry, had to clean up for a second, but you know, the bottom line, my house. Oh, Jesus, not to get that on film. But I just appreciate your program. I think it's good for the community to have, you know, everyday folks on here. Regardless of titles, I'm not in the titles. You know, if you got something good and positive to add to put out there to the community, we need to do that. And I want to add, there's a job fair at Essex County College. I believe it's May 15th. So right after the election, May 15th, we have it's a Thursday. It's a job fair at Essex County College. I believe it's from 10 to 3. So if this is going to air like on the 10th, people need to make sure they're down at Essex County College.
Check my show out on the 10th, and then go down there on the 15th and get yourself a job.
How you doing? My name is Maryam Dilettante Bass. My number is 2C, South Ward Councilman, vote May 13, 2014.
What makes you the best candidate for the job?
I would say the fact that I have been committed to working with the people in our community for over 30 years. It's my experience. And the fact that I owned a school for 10 years, so education is top priority to me. The next thing is that I've been involved in my community for over 30 years. I raised my children here. I got married here. I got divorced here. I bought two homes here. I still live in one of those homes. I believe in Newark. And I think that we're at the point now, especially in the West Ward, where we need to have a leader who is committed to providing a quality of life, which is a good quality of life for all residents in the West Ward. My issue right now with the West Ward is the fact that there's been no development in the West Ward for over 32 years. I have a real serious problem with that because it tells me what our leadership has thought about their residents for over 32 years. And the fact that I believe that it's what a person's intentions are. So what makes me the best candidate is the fact that I've been a school board president. I worked with a council member. I was responsible for the activities and what's going on in the West Ward. I did a very good job, you know, in that because I like working with people. And my bottom line is that I'm results oriented. Like, people like to talk about certain things. I'm not one to like to talk about it. I want to see the results. Right. And right now, we have not developed the West Ward. And the reason why I'm talking so much about development is because what development does is that it creates jobs. I'm not talking about a Dunkin' Donuts job or a laundromat job. And all of those are good, but that only gets maybe one or two people a job. I'm talking about some serious jobs here in the West Ward, and it's possible. So again, it goes back to what a person's intentions are. So what makes me the best candidate is that the fact that I ran against the machine in 2010. I was the only candidate that did that. Now we have eight people who are running, including myself, and I dared to run against an incumbent. And so now that the incumbent is not running, other people want to run. And I'm not saying that people don't have the right to run, but what I am saying is that people need to look at the records of the folks who are running, right, and see what their commitments are. I've been working in the prison system now for over 10 years. So I know a lot of the brothers and sisters who have been on the streets and everything. So that makes me qualified. And the fact, again, is that what my intentions are. I don't have a hidden agenda. You know, the only agenda that I have is that I want to see us all live a quality of life. That when you become a senior citizen, like I will be soon, you know, I'm an elder. When you become a senior citizen, you want to be able to feel safe. That's why public safety is so important. And with your children, you want to have good schools. That's why when you're young, when you look in the neighborhoods, you're looking to see what type of schools we have. That's one of the reasons why Cammie Anderson, who is our superintendent right now, she has to go because she's a real estate broker as opposed to an educator. So for all those reasons, along with some other things that I've done. Like I said, if you go to my website, which is MaryamBay.com, mm-hmm. you'll see everything that I've been doing for over 30 years.
In your opinion, why do you think so many people was running?
Because now in the West Ward, it's because they can. You know, no one wants to run against an incumbent. Nobody wanted to run against, the Rices and everything. Yeah. So now that he's not running, Junior is not running, now everybody wants to run. Mm-hmm. And like I said, everybody is entitled to run, but the difference with me is that I ran against the incumbent
right.
because I'm not afraid. Mm-hmm. And that's the difference too. We need to have someone who doesn't mind bucking the system, and I've always been known to do that. So basically, since
those guys is going, they feel as though, oh, okay, I got a chance to
now
win.
I got exactly. Right. Exactly. Right. That's why I'm saying that the people need to look at everybody's record mm-hmm. and see what they have been doing, not 6 months ago or a year ago or even 2 years ago. Look and see what their commitment has been over the past, let's give them 5-6 years. See what they've been doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you look at my record, you'll see that when we were talking, when we talk about violence, mm-hmm. I've been doing things about that. I gave two forums on public safety and also violence as a mental health issue, because it is a mental health issue. And we did a conference, a 2-day conference on violence. You know, so like again, I said, I just don't talk about it. I am about it. And the most important thing, the way you help people is you provide them with information. And it's the information that empowers them, mm-hmm. you know, and that's why I do what I do.
Mm-hmm.
Around the individual. Mm-hmm. That right there within itself makes me the best candidate. Because if you look at most of the candidates, they're one-sided, one-track mind, and then a lot of them say the same rhetoric. If you listen to their speeches or listen to what they say now, you go back 4 years, it's the same thing that was said before. 4 years before that, 4 years. So it's like to say, if nothing's happened yet and that mm-hmm. method didn't work and you keep saying the same thing, mm-hmm. obviously you're not the best person for the job. If you look at all the candidates, they'll say the same exact, we need more cops. We need more this. We need more recreation. But they never tell you what they really mean by that. Me, I will tell you what I mean by that. First of all, before you even say we need more cops, we have to figure out how we're going to raise the money to get more cops. In other words, one, we have to look in the budget itself. A method to raise money that I thought of, we can do what New York City does. Instead of making, if your car get towed, it get towed by a private company. New York City, if your car get towed, it gets towed by New York City police. And what happens, you go to 42nd Street in the West Side and you pay them directly. And it could be 2 o'clock in the morning, they're open. That money goes straight to the police department. Now imagine if the towing was in the police department and all the money goes straight to the police department and the police budget. So now you just save money that way. You made money for the police compared to it going out. And then we also can make it so that when the person's car gets towed, they don't have to go to Green Street, go here, go there, get a release form. They just go straight to the tow site, show the ID, the money, and they're gone. Another way we can save money is, I always say, let's remove the police officers off the horses. Take them off the horses, put them on bicycles, takes the cops out of the cars, put them on bicycles. Therefore, we're promoting health, and they'll be in the neighborhood, and they'll be seen. And then we take those same horses, create a youth program with the horses. And then at the same time, we can also provide ways though you and I as adults can come pay a fee and go horseback riding. Just how they do in Wah Chong and other places. Sometimes we can just look at other cities and copy the same thing. We have the resources. So this makes me different because I think outside the box. I travel, I study. And what I do, I say, hey, we got to bring these same thing to North. So for me, I want to represent a different stakeholder in the city. I want to represent the thinkers. I want to represent the doers. Along with the other people who need help. Because there's a lot of people need help, but sometimes they just want somebody to show them. Most of these people are running, honest the truth, you never saw them before a day in the neighborhood. No one could vouch for them nowhere. People throw community events all the time in the South Ward City of Newark. I'm at everybody event, but I never see them there. You can have a basketball game in a community. They never there, but then they'll tell you they're community orientated. See, sometimes you got to look at it like this. I always say the circumstances don't make the individual. It reveals who they are. And based on the circumstance as before us, it reveals all that matters to them is their own ego. See, if you're truly about the community, you would have been about it way before this election stuff. But no one can vouch for it. You can't go to none of these high schools, these principals say, have they ever come and talked to the kids? They'll say, no. You can't go nowhere. And then they join organizations just for political purposes, not for the right intentions. So for me, what makes me a better candidate is not only just being well-rounded, but also being seen in the community because I realize I'm also a part of the community. And that's what we got to realize. And so if you know you're part of the community, you want the best for yourself, you're going to want the best for your community. Because that's the way it goes. So when you look at me versus the other candidates, I do things different. I'm into technology. They're not. I'm into STEM programs, which means science, technology, engineering, math. That's where every other city is heading. But if these guys never even mention it, that shows they don't have the skills or the capability or the know-how to take us there. We can't say we're going to compete with Jersey City if we keep electing people who don't have the capability and the skill set like the other elected officials in other cities. You know, like, if other elected officials saying, huh, we can't just build buildings. We got to put buildings with solar panels on it so it saves the city money. By these guys talking about some, oh, we need to figure out what we're going to do with the vacant lot. What? This is how they're Arcanian in their thoughts. But they talk about they want to lead you. But they can't even lead themselves to a place of peace and happiness. And when they talk about crime, if you notice, like we were saying earlier, what they always constantly talk, the gangs. Last I checked, that's not a real issue in the community. People have to realize the gang issue is a financial number added to that. If you keep mentioning gangs, or you create this thing of crime, you can apply for federal funding to get money, so they got to make it seem more than what it is. Not to say it may not be an issue, but the real issue is economics. The real issue is family, education. Exactly. So for me, I look at my background. I said I worked in the city, economic development office, director's office, that deals with business and money. And you really see the real fallacies and flaws of the city. I worked in the UEZ, which dealt with small business, urban enterprise, and I would go to small businesses and hear their plight, hear their stories, understand what they're going through. Did a lot of community work, feedings, homeless, farms, you name it, did it, basketball tournaments, do all that stuff. Even today, take kids camping, this, that, but I don't get paid to do this stuff. A lot of them, they'll say I'm community oriented, but they get a paycheck. That's the difference. They get a paycheck. When you do it from the heart,
right,
it's something different. When you go out and coach kids and you don't get paid, that's something different. See, people want you to vote for them either for namesake purposes or some legacy thing. But it's never on what have you really done. And then they try to hype these people up like that's really something. When it's nothing, like, brother, everybody's a mentor that's positive in this community. You got to come with a little more than that. So it's like, for me, I represent substance. I can go in any city and stand strong by myself. I built my own name up, but not by myself, by people supporting me because they realize he's a person of substance and character. when you look at these people and you go talk to them, you don't even feel the realness. You be like, ugh, he's just the same old character. Why? Because we don't believe in him anymore. So if you don't believe in these individuals, anything they do or say, it won't turn out to anything. Because it's hollow underneath.
Okay, I just want to remind the people that Election Day is May 13th, and my ballot number is C77C. And we just want to also remind you that after you vote for the mayor, you can vote for any other candidate. You don't have to vote for the team.